Welcome to Talk EM, brought to you by the Emergency Medicine Institute, where our whole goal is promoting clinical excellence. Our focus is for the advanced practitioners, emergency medicine, nurse practitioners, and physician assistants who work in the field of taking care of people who are acutely sick. Our whole goal is just that, promoting clinical excellence, to discuss the issues that are pertinent to us in clinical practice. Welcome to the podcast. I think it's always important, if you work in primary care, emergency medicine, urgent care, to have updated information on the latest antibiotics for common medical problems. So I've gone through Sanford's guide and broken down the common antibiotics, and I got to tell you something. I had one update that will change my practice. So let's just look at this. Otitis media in children. First off, to diagnose it, there's one of four options. Moderate to severe bulging of the tympanic membrane, new onset of otorrhea, mild bulging, and recent onset of ear pain, so that's less than 48 hours of ear tugging, rubbing the ear in a nonverbal child, or intense erythema of the tympanic membrane. So we have bulging, discharge, a combination of bulging and ear pain, or intense erythema of the tympanic membrane. Now, it's recommended that if there's severe otitis media, as indicated by symptoms going on greater than 48 hours or a temp of greater than 102.2, pull the trigger on antibiotics. Now, less than 2 years old, you should treat. That's the deal. Less than 2 years old, JAMA is suggesting that you treat. If their patient's greater than 2 years old, it's reasonable to observe for 48 hours or begin antibiotics. Know that in a patient that's not febrile, there's been very good results in holding antibiotics. Now, pediatric acute otitis media, they're recommending high dose amoxicillin or Augmentin. That is under the condition that there's no antibiotic in the last 30 days, no conjunctivitis, and no history of recurrent acute otitis media. Now, you should be asking, like I did, why are they talking about conjunctivitis here? I'm going to talk about that in a second, because that really is a practice changer for me. So amoxicillin, high dose is 90 milligrams per kilogram per day, BID or TID, and Augmentin, 90 milligrams per kilogram divided BID. Now, when is Augmentin preferred? Well, it's preferred if there's been antibiotics in the last 30 days, if they failed amoxicillin and it may take 3 days to respond, if there's purulent conjunctivitis, again, we're going to talk about that in a second, and a history of recurrent acute otitis media. Know that in JAMA, they felt and found that Augmentin gave better resolution of effusions if used Augmentin. Now, conjunctivitis otitis syndrome. So if you have anybody with a conjunctivitis, a kidlet, you really need to look at the tympanic membrane. So when we look at the eye, this is super important. A couple things you got to look for. First off is visual acuity. Make sure you're always doing visual acuity, and you want to look at the eye and see, is there a white line next to the iris? If so, that's the limbus, and it's clear if it's white. Now, that suggests a more benign superficial eye. So if the injection goes right up to the iris, then that tells me it's a deeper problem. If there is a line of white, that's the cornea on top of the iris, that tells me it's more of a superficial problem. So subconjunctival hemorrhage is homogeneously erythematous, but again, it has that about 1 millimeter line surrounding the iris. Now, conjunctivitis otitis syndrome means that about 1 out of 4 patients with conjunctivitis will have concurrent otitis media. And even if they have no ear pain, the chief complaint is just conjunctivitis. So every patient with conjunctivitis needs to have an examination of the tympanic membrane. If they have both together, they need oral antibiotics. So H. flu is the most commonly recovered bacteria that's identified both in the middle of the ear, and it's the same germ found in conjunctival discharge. Therefore, they need oral Augmentin. So the take-home point here, guys, is every single patient here on out, if they have a conjunctivitis, you have to document a normal ear exam. And if they have an abnormal ear exam, they get treated with Augmentin. So adults with acute otitis media, if the patient has had no antibiotics in the prior month, amoxicillin high dose, so it's 1,000 milligrams TID, that's kind of like a triple, that's kind of like a double dose relative to how I used to treat. I used to treat 500 milligrams TID. Now they're saying 1,000 milligrams, 1 gram TID, or Augmentin ER, 2,000 milligrams BID. Now, if the patient has had antibiotics in the past month, then they're immediately going to recommend the Augmentin, the 2,000 milligrams BID, or fluoroquinolone, levofloxacin or moxifloxacin, and levofloxacin 750 milligrams daily for 5 days, It's a five-day course. The other two are typically a 10-day course. Cellulitis. Now, cellulitis is heralded by rapidly spreading red erythematous, tender plaque-like areas. Usually it's unilateral. Often the patient is febrile. When they have a cellulitis, you want to look for signs of systemic spread, such as lymphangitis or lymphadenopathy. And understand that when you have someone with cellulitis, it's recommended that you look at their feet because the portal of entry is often a tinea infection. Now, PO agents versus MRSA, Clinda, Bactrim, or trimethoprim sulfamexazole and doxycycline. Know that the efficacy of clindamycin and Bactrim for the treatment of uncomplicated skin infections really is comparable. And that's in the New England Journal of Medicine. UTI in females. With no signs of pyelo, you always do a culture and always consider STD. Now, Bactrim is still recommended. Bactrim DS 1 tab BID times 3 days plus or minus pyridium. If a sulfa allergy is there, nitrofurantoin 100 milligrams POBID for 5 days. Now, do not use nitrofurantoin in the last trimester of pregnancy because of a hemolytic anemia in the newborn, and fluoroquinolones are not recommended as a primary regime because of the resistance to fluoroquinolones often parallels that resistance to Bactrim. Now, when it comes to strep throat, the center's criteria, it's not great, but it's the best we got. So CENT, C-E-N-T, is there a cough? Remember, that's a pertinent negative. Strep should not cough. Exudates, nodes, or cervical lymphadenopathy. And temp, do they have a fever? Now, CENT or, you want to say, or could they have mono? Now, according to center's criteria, if the patient is between 3 and 12 years old, they also get a point. So we have a total of possibly 5 points they can get for center's criteria. So if they have 3, they have about a 30% chance of strep. If they have 4 or greater, it goes up to about 52%. Again, not great, but a lot of times the rapid strep tests are not very reliable. So what's the rationale for treating strep throat? Well, it decreases symptoms. It decreases the suppurative complications, such as peritonsil or abscess. It decreases how contagious they are, and it prevents rheumatic fever. And rheumatic fever is still a problem in many parts of the world, especially in children. And just know that benzene penicillin in the treatment of group A streptococcus decreased the rate of acute rheumatic fever from 2.8% down to 0.2%. So complications of untreated strep is acute rheumatic fever, post-streptococcal reactive arthritis, also known as Reiter syndrome, peritonsil abscess or retropharyngeal abscess, and the suppurative phlebitis. That's fascinating. It's also contributes to jugular venous thromboembolism-like disease, very scary disease. And kids less than 7 years old, they can have post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. So the primary regimes of people with strep throat, well, just penicillin. 250 milligrams POBID or TID, or 500 milligrams POBID, depending on their weight. And that'll go on for 10 days. So if it's less than about 60 pounds, you use the 250 milligrams POBID or TID. If greater than 60 pounds, the 500 milligrams POBID. Now the benzene penicillin, 25,000 units per kilogram IM, one shot. Amoxicillin is a suspension because the amoxicillin suspension tastes a whole lot better than the penicillin does. 50 milligrams per kilogram once daily times 10 days. Again, that's amoxicillin, 50 milligrams per kilogram PO once daily for 10 days, or Augmentin, 45 milligrams per kilogram BID in adults. It's penicillin V, 500 milligrams BID, or 250 PO QID times 10 days, or Augmentin, 875 PO BID times 10 days. Now, community-acquired pneumonia. I always find this a little bit interesting, where the CURB 65 rule is used to decide who needs to be admitted with pneumonia, and I don't feel I've ever struggled with that. But CURB 65, so if they're confused, they have a BUN of greater than 19, if the respiratory rate is greater than 30, if they're hypotensive with the pressure less than 90 over 60, and if they're over the age of 65, they get 1 point for each one of those. Now, if the score is 1, outpatient therapy is reasonable. But the bottom line is, guys, if someone's breathing at 32, I'm not sending them home. If they're hypotensive, I'm not sending them home. If they're confused, I'm not sending them home. It doesn't make any sense. But this may be used to leverage your hospitalists. So the primary regimes, azithromycin, 500 milligrams PO times 1 dose, then 250 PO Q24 hours. Now, so that's the 5-day course. It's a Z-Pak, and boy, I'm not a big fan of that. Clarithromycin 500 milligrams POBID or clarithromycin ER 1 gram PO acute 24 hours times 7 days. Now, if the patient has had antibiotics in the last 3 months, they're recommending a dual regime, so azithromycin or clarithromycin, so something that covers the atypicals with either amoxicillin, Augmentin, or Levaquin. So they're recommending a combined therapy. So the macrolide antibiotic with amoxicillin 1 gram POB TID or Augmentin 1,000 milligrams 2 tabs POB AD or Levaquin 750 POQ 24 hours. Now, if there's comorbidities present, they recommend the Levaquin 750 POQ 24 hours times 5 days. Pilo. Now, they have to have a temp of greater than 102 with costovertebral tenderness. You want to culture the urine and the blood. In males, look for any kind of complicated pathology. And what are some of the things that would make us think complications? Well, in the presence of an obstruction, underlying renal disease, males shouldn't have pylos. Immunosuppression, if they've had a kidney stone at the same time, anatomical or functional urinary tract abnormalities, all of that, we would put them into the category of a complicated pylo. So outpatient therapy, Cipro, 500 milligrams POBAD, or the extended release, 1,000 milligrams Q24. Levaquin, 750 milligrams Q24 hours, or oxyfloxacin, 400 milligrams BID for 5 to 7 days. For clinical settings, which a prevalence of fluoroquinolone resistance is greater than 10%, they're recommending 1 gram of ceftriaxone or 1 dose of gentamicin. Now, sinusitis, just understand there's a high degree of spontaneous resolution. We really need to be smart about the use of antihistamines because the gook in the sinuses is what's making them sick, and antihistamines will dry them out and make them worse. Know that allergies, smoking, and URIs, those are what typically blocks the ostia and fills them up. Now, our goal with sinusitis is to get the crap out, and we thin it out, the mucus, with lots of fluids, and we open the ostia with the decongestants. So antibiotics are rarely needed. It's usually a result of the obstruction of the sinus ostia, typically viral infections or allergens, and treatment is oral fluids and perhaps nasal saline irrigation. Now, sinus symptoms are common with viral infections and allergies and are a common cause of overuse of antibiotics. So the guidelines indicate antibiotic therapy in one of three situations. They got a fever of greater than 39 or higher in children, intense facial pain, or purulent nasal discharge. If despite withholding antibiotics, patients still have symptoms after 10 days, then it's recommended that you pull the trigger on antibiotics. Now, a meta-analysis of 9 double-blinded trials found no clinical signs and symptoms that justified treatment, even after 7 to 10 days, and that was in Lancet. And in JAMA, in a randomized placebo-controlled trial in adults, a 10-day course of amoxicillin compared to placebo did not reduce symptoms at day 3 of therapy. Okay, so my hope is this helps in the update of antibiotics for primary care or urgent care-like complaints. Today's podcast is brought to you by American Medical Seminars. American Medical Seminars holds conferences in Sarasota, Florida, and San Diego on a number of different primary care topics, such as emergency medicine, infectious disease, orthopedics, dermatology. So please take a look. All classes have this sunrise see-me schedule, meaning that you're only in class for about 4 hours in the morning. 8 until 12:15, 4 hours in the morning, then you get to relax and enjoy in an amazing location. Good luck and God bless. Thank you for joining us today on Talk EM, where our whole goal is promoting clinical excellence, targeting advanced practitioners. Follow us on social media and subscribe to the show so you never miss an episode. That's emergencymedicinetalkem.com. Again, that's emergencymedicinetalkem.com.